Hello, I'm Covey Jones, the big game coordinator for the Division of Wildlife, and I'm here to present the 2020 Antlerless Recommendations for the Division. Before we start, I think it's important to remember why we issue antlerless permits for big game in the state. So one of the reasons is to manage to a population objective. So state code requires that the division set and maintain and manage two population objectives. So when you see us increase or decrease permits on given units, a lot of times it's to manage to the objective that we've agreed to manage to. Part of the reason for that is that although we love deer and elk, we have to remember at the times when resources are limiting, they can have negative impacts on some members in our state, and even negative impacts on themselves. And that leads into the next reason. So herd health. So at the time of most limited resource, or in Utah, our winters for most of our populations can really cause problems for ungulates or for deer and elk and moose and other species if we have too many of them on the landscape. And so we set antlerless permits to make sure we have the appropriate number of animals in the landscape. And then we monitor body condition and we look at cause-specific mortality to see if we do have too many or if we can have more animals on the landscape. Another reason is because too many animals in the landscape can damage range conditions into the future, lowering our carrying capacity or lowering the number of animals we can have for years to come. And so we monitor our range carefully to make sure that we have the appropriate number of animals on the landscape. And finally, and as I mentioned before, these animals can have a negative impact on private property. So from depredation to urban conflict, we use antlerless permits to address and help alleviate those issues. Starting with fawn production trends. Now, over the last few years, we've watched on the left side, we have fawns per 100 does. And then along the bottom, we have the year. Up through the end of 2019 we can see that on the bottom of the graph it's every other year, and that's why 2019 doesn't show up. But this data is through the end of 2019. So last fall when we went and looked at fawn doe ratios, our fawn doe ratios were about 53, which honestly is lower than what we'd like to see them. When we look at stable deer populations, this number is really important. This number combined with fawn survival. So a stable to increasing deer population will have a fawn doe ratio of 60. Over winter, you can end up losing half of those, and an adult doe survival of 85%. So when we see this number drop below 60, we start to keep a really close eye on it. And it's environmental factors primarily that drive this number. So it's drought and other things that can reduce that. For 2019, this number was obviously lower. Survival looks really good over winter of 2020, and we suspect that in fall of 2020, this number will be back up where we need it to be. Looking at our statewide deer survival rates, so this is monitoring survival, again, through the end of 2019. So a survival year is monitored from December of the previous year to December of last year. So when we look at this data here, what we're looking at is survival rates from December of 2018 through the end of December 2019. And we can see that our statewide adult doe survival dropped there below 80%, as I mentioned previously. So we have our survival percentage on the left-hand side and followed by the year across the bottom. So as I mentioned previously, we like to see this number of adult doe survival. West-wide average is 85%. So when we start to drop below that, it's concerning. Also, statewide fawn survival last year was lower than what we'd like to see, it at about 37%. And this led to all this data is taken into account when we project the number of animals on the landscape. So when we model last year's population, we saw quite a decrease from previous years. So in 2018, our modeled population estimate was 372,500, with the numbers above the line. We've got population estimate on the y-axis, And on the x-axis across the bottom, we have the year. So we took a dive from that to a model population estimate for 2019 of 321,000 animals on the landscape. And you'll see a corresponding reduction in our antlerless permits for deer. Now, there are still areas where there's a need for antlerless permits, and still areas where we have concerns. Not all the areas were hit the same when we look at this, and not all antlerless permits are for the same reason. And so we still have a need for some of these permits, but far fewer than we did in 2019. So with that, we'll look at antlerless permits by region and then by unit within that region. Again, as a reminder, antlerless deer hunts are designed to address deer population health, depredation, urban conflict, or rangeland concerns. So on the Chalk Creek, on the left-hand side, we have the region. Under that, we have the units within the region, followed by last year's permit recommendation and then this year's recommendations. On the Chalk Creek, recommending a reduction there, half those permits, and recommending reduction on the East Canyon, as well as a slight reduction on the 9 Mile, and that area is in and around Green River Valley, and then on the San Juan Abajo, and that's in the town of Monticello. For southern region, recommending reductions across the board here on the Beaver, Monroe, Mount Dutton. On the Panguitch Lake, recommending a significant reduction from 150 to 10 to address some specific issues. And on the Pine Valley, recommending a hefty reduction there. On the Plateau Boulder, recommending to remove that hunt. A significant reduction on the Southwest Desert, and recommending to remove any hunts on the Zion. Under the northeastern region, still have some concerns on the North Slope, recommending to maintain those 50 permits. And then on the South Slope, this hunt is to target an area. As part of the statewide deer plan, we passed an appendix to the plan, which has a CWD plan. And one of the strategies to managing and mitigating chronic wasting disease, or CWD, is to have targeted hunts that focus on areas or hotspots. So on the South Slope, this is a new hunt in an area where we have some concerns with chronic wasting disease, and recommending those permits as targeted removal. Under our elk recommendations, our statewide elk population dipped as well. And we don't see survival rates in elk dip as much. But one of the things we did see on some of the units were affected is that our cow-calf ratios were lower. So as they went through this extreme drought and severe winter, we ended up with fewer calves on the landscape, and that's partially responsible for this reduction in population. We're still hovering right almost at the population objective for the state, with a projected 76,000 550 elk in the state. Now, antlerless elk, we have changed the way we manage these. When we rewrote the statewide elk plan in 2015, we realized that issuing all the antlerless elk permits through the public draw was making it so that our elk were completely unavailable to sportsmen, or not completely, but very unavailable. They were hard to target, and we were ending up with a lot of elk on private lands or in areas where they couldn't be harvested, and we weren't accomplishing the management that we wanted to accomplish. So we switched some strategies, and we still have those public draw permits, and it's still important to be able to offer that and harvest those animals on public land where we can. But to move those animals back and forth between private and public land, we also now offer private lands only permits. And there are a lot of units where that strategy is helping maintain the public opportunity, because it pushes those elk back off of private land to where they again are available and accessible to the public hunters. It also allows the landowner to alleviate the damage that he may feel from having an overabundance of elk on his personal private property. And then in areas where we are not managing for a significant population of elk, we have antlerless elk control permits. And those are a permit that you can obtain with your buck or bull permit for the unit and harvest an antlerless elk at the time that you're out hunting either your buck or your bull. So here's what that looks like. You can see the number of permits there on the left-hand side, followed by the year across the bottom. We have the black line, which is the number of antlerless elk permits that we offer through the draw. And then we have the purple line stacked on top of that, which is the number of private lands only permits that we're offering across the state. So you can see in public draw permits, we have taken a decrease since our high years in 2013 and 2014. But we've maintained pressure on these elk and harvest where we need to through those private lands only permits. So on these slides, on the left-hand side, we'll see the unit, followed by the population objective, and then the population estimate. And that's either a model estimate or a flown estimate. We fly our elk units every 3 years and attempt to do a complete census. The next column is the 2019 permits, followed by the 2020 permit recommendations. Looking at what we're recommending by unit for antlerless elk across the state. Also, it's important to note that on some of these units where we are over objective and may not be recommending a significant increase, some of these units, especially in the northern region, are dominated by private land. So the public harvest is only part of this. And working with CWMUs and operators to increase the harvest on private land is another part of this, and as well as private lands only permits. So on the box elder, we're recommending a slight decrease there as we're at the population objective. Recommending a decrease on the cash as well, a slight decrease. On the camas, recommending an increase. And on the Morgan South Ridge, where we're quite a ways above the population objective, recommending a slight increase there. But that's one of those units where we're working with CWU operators as well. And then recommending a decrease on the Ogden, where we're down quite a ways below the population objective there. Onto the Book Cliffs. We're below the population objective there as well, but we've been doing some research on the Book Cliffs. And one of the things that we've noticed is that it appears that we've missed several years worth of recruitment there, or haven't had the number of elk coming into the population that we would like to see. And missed years of recruitment is probably wrong, but recruiting it at a slower rate is more accurate. And what that means is that just not having as many cows per 100 calves as we would like to see in a population. So part of the reason for this is because we could be up against a carrying capacity for elk. And so these permits have a couple purposes. One is to look at that and see if we can harvest some of those elk and make these populations more productive again. But the other one is to look at average age of harvest and see if we really have an older aging elk population, which would mean that we don't have the number of elk recruiting into that population every year. And that's the reason for the increase in permits there. On the 9 Mile Anthro, above and recommending a slight increase in permits there. North Slope West Daggett, below and recommending a decrease. South Slope Diamond Mountain, slightly above and recommending a small increase. And then on the Wasatch Mountains of Inniquin, we're above and recommending an increase there as well. Looking at the public draw permits for the central region, starting with the Nebo, above and recommending a slight increase there. On Wasatch Mountains West, we're at what we're managing for there and recommending only a 5 permit increase. On Central Mountains Manti, this is one of the units that we did a population census on this last year. So as our estimate there is below what we're managing for, recommending quite a reduction there from 600 to 445. On the LaSalle Mountains above and recommending an increase for an overall net increase in that region. Onto the southern region. On several of these units in the southern region, we have an objective that we're managing for or a range. Instead of just when the plans were rewritten in this unit, the committees felt like they wanted to see a range of elk. A lot of these units are a big complex of elk that move back and forth between summer and winter ranges, An elk that you may see on the Dutton in the winter and be counted towards the Dutton population objective may summer on the Boulder. But overall, we flew these units this last year, several of them coming in at the bottom end of the range or below, and so we're recommending decreases on the Beaver, the Fillmore, the Monroe, Mount Dutton, the Ponsagant, the Plateau Boulder Kaparowitz. On the Fish Lake, recommending a slight increase there to deal with some issues that we have there, and then recommending a decrease on the Southwest Desert and a decrease on the Zion. Overall, net decrease from 3,380 permits in the southern region to 1,900 permits. Looking at some of the new hunts, and new hunts to address areas of concern or issues, or to better harvest these animals when they're where they're more available, or to address depredation or conflict. So recommending two new hunts on the Beaver East, a few new hunts on the Bookless Bitter Creek South, one on Central Mountains Manti, one in the Fillmore Kanawha Valley, two on the Morgan South Ridge, one on the Panguitch Lake, and one on the West Desert Tinnick Valley. If you have any questions about the boundaries on these hunts, the boundaries are available in the RAC packet. For antlers control, these are one type of over-the-counter permits. So this is the one where a hunter may take an antlerless elk using the same weapon type during the same season dates and within the areas of overlap between the boundary of the buck, bull, or once-in-a-lifetime permit and the antlerless elk control permit. Private lands only permits are only valid on private land, and these permits are valid from August 1st through January 31st of 2021 if you buy one for this hunting season. Again, the sell date for permits is July 22nd. So last year, we had antlerless elk control permits were available on 8 units. So we sold 3,254 of these permits and harvested 348 elk for about an 11% success rate. And for 2020, we're recommending those permits on the same 8 units, so no changes there. For private lands only permits, last year we sold 3,813 of these permits. And with that, we harvested 1,420 elk, or about a 37% success rate. These permits have been really well received by landowners and hunters, simplified the process to obtain permits when we do have a problem or a depredation issue, and help minimize that depredation. They also, as I mentioned earlier in the presentation, redistribute elk on the landscape, at times making them more available to the public. Here's the list of antlerless elk private lands only permits, as well as the number of permits that we're recommending. So on the left-hand side, you've got the unit, followed by the number of permits recommended for that unit last year, followed by the number of permits recommended for that unit this year. A slight decrease there on Beaver East, and on Fillmore Oak Creek, where we didn't need those permits or aren't having the conflict that we've had there. Recommending an increase on the LaSalle's and on the Morgan South Ridge, where we're well above the objective. Recommending decreases on the North Slope West Daggett and Ogden units, as well as a discontinuation of these permits on the Santa Fell. A slight decrease on the West Desert Tinnick Valley, along with a decrease on the Zion, for an overall decrease from 9,785 to 9,190 private lands only permits. To doe pronghorn permit recommendations. So we've seen our doe pronghorn, again, as we mentioned before, like our deer, our elk, our doe pronghorn permit recommendations, we need fewer of those to manage to what we've had as we went through the hard year in 2019. Hard summer of 2018 followed by a more severe winter in 2019. So recommending to go from 760 of those permits to 525. Recommending reductions. If you look at the unit on the left-hand side followed by 2019's permits and then 2020 permit rec, recommending reductions on the Beaver, on the Cache, and on the Mount Dutton Poncegon with an increase on the Box Elder. We're well below the population objective on the Parker, recommending to turn those hunts off this year and have no permits, as well as a reduction on the Santa Fe, the South Slope, and Southwest Desert, with increases on the Panguitch Lake and Pine Valley, a new hunt there in the Pine Valley where we have a population of pronghorn now. For antlerless moose recommendations, recommending a new hunt on the Morgan South Ridge. Recommending to discontinue the Ogden moose hunt. And recommending a reduction on the Ogden West for an overall reduction in permits from 38 to 31 antlerless moose. We're also recommending a new hunt on the Box Elder Newfoundland Mountain sheep. We brought this hunt before the racks and the boards, along with the sheep planner, the ability to hunt ewes. And we do this for a couple of reasons. One, obviously, the sheep, they increase and increase, and we want to maintain these sheep within the unit management boundaries. And part of the reason is because of disease. So when we end up with too many sheep on a unit, they start to venture out. And the chances of them coming in contact with mycoplasma, one of the diseases that could negatively impact the population, and coming back to the population increases with density. It also decreases body condition with density, or the animals, they become less productive, having fewer offspring. And the Newfoundland Mountains is one of the areas where we know we have a lot of sheep out there. And so recommending to start out and hunt a few of those ewes and try to manage that population at a more appropriate level. Recommending 10 permits for next year. And that's all for antlerless. If you have any comments, please click on the link below.